children of God, it is true that the death of Christ on the cross of Calvary has atoned for many of our sins. But I'm here to tell us today that there is a sin that the death and the blood of Christ is not atoned for. Because it is a sin that goes against the words of the song that was just sung to us by the choir today, that our God is unstoppable. It is a sin that goes against the divinity of the Most High God. It is a sin that attacks the existence of God. It is a sin, children of the Most High God, that says unto God that God is unable to do those impossible things that seem impossible in your eyes and in my eyes. And that sin, children of God, is unbelief. I'm not talking about the unbelief that is displayed by men and women who have decided that Christ is not the way. I'm not talking about the unbelief that is displayed by the government of this country that have succeeded in removing the name of God from our schools. I'm talking about the unbelief of men and women who are called by the name of God. Men and women who have experienced the goodness of God, but yet continue to doubt the mightiness of this God. I'm talking about the unbelief that you and I display on a daily basis. Because the book of 1 John 5:10 tells us that he that does not believe in God has made God a liar. He that does not believe in God has made God a liar. And when we read today's first lesson, book of Numbers 11 from 16, we realize that that's exactly what the children of Israel did. Let's pick up that story from verse 18. From verse 18.
Say
unto the people,
sanctify yourselves against tomorrow.
Sanctify yourselves against tomorrow.
And ye shall eat flesh.
And you shall eat flesh.
For ye have wept in the ears of the Lord, saying,
because you have cried unto the ears of God, saying,
who shall give us flesh to eat?
Who shall give us flesh to eat?
For it was well with us in Egypt.
Because while we were in Egypt, it was well with us.
Therefore, the Lord will give you flesh.
The Lord will give you flesh, yes.
Ye shall eat.
Yes.
Ye shall not eat one day.
You will not eat one day.
Nor 2 days.
Nor 2 days.
Nor 5 days.
Nor 5 days.
Neither 10 days.
Uh-huh.
Nor 20 days.
Yes.
But even a whole month.
Yes.
Until it come out at your nostrils.
You will eat so much that food will start popping out of your eyes and your nostrils.
And it be loathsome unto you.
Uh-huh.
Because that ye have despised the Lord.
Because you have despised the Lord. Despite all the great things that he has done in your life. Yet you continue to show a heart of unbelief before God. Yes.
The Lord which is among you,
uh-huh,
have wept before him, saying,
yes,
why came we forth out of Egypt?
Uh-huh.
And Moses said,
the man of God said,
the people,
yes,
among whom I am,
yes,
are 600,000.
He said, these people are 600,000, yes.
And thou hast said,
and God, you have said,
I will give them flesh.
I will give them flesh.
That they may eat a whole month.
Uh-huh.
Shall the flocks and the herds be slavery.
Here is the man of God, Moses, a man who is beloved by God, a man through whom the Lord parted the Red Sea, now questioning this unstoppable God, saying, yes,
shall the flocks and the herds be slain for them?
Shall the flocks and this herd be slain for them?
To suffice them.
To suffice them. God, are you sure you're going to be able to do this?
Or yeah, shall all the flesh of the sea be gathered together for them,
uh-huh,
to suffice them?
Yes.
And the Lord said unto Moses,
and the Lord said unto Moses,
is the Lord's hand waxed short?
Is the hand of God too short?
Thou shalt see now.
No, thank you. Are the hands of God too short? The amazing thing about the story of the Israelites is this. If you think about all the ugly sins that were listed against them in the wilderness, sins of sexual immorality, sins of rebellion, sins of idolatry. None of those sins stood in their way of getting into the promised land. They were punished for it, but it never prevented them from getting into the promised land. The sin that stood in their way was that sin of unbelief. Hebrews 3 from 17. Imagine, God said, do not kill. They killed, but yet God's promise stood upon their life. Do not commit adultery. They did, but yet the promise of God remained with them. Yes.
But with whom was he grieved 40 years?
He said, with whom was he grieved those 40 years?
Was it not with them that had sinned?
Was it not with them that had sinned?
Whose carcasses fell in the wilderness?
Yes.
And to whom swore he that they should not enter into his rest?
He swore that they will not enter into his rest.
But to them that believed not.
But to them that believed not.
So we see that they could not enter in.
Yes, because
of unbelief.
They could not enter into that promised land because of unbelief, children of God. When you look God in the eye and you tell him that he's not a great God, when you tell your problem that your problem is greater than God, even after experiencing the goodness and the might of God, may the wrath of God never be kindled against us in Jesus' name. We all know who Moses was. Moses was a man that was loved by God. He was a man that asked God to show him himself, and the Lord answered. He was a man that God spoke to face, and the Lord was always there with him. But there were two occasions in my little understanding of the Bible where Moses pleaded with God for mercy that the Lord did not hearken unto him. Two places, two occasions. Number one, in the book of Numbers 14, from verse 18. When the children of God...
The Lord is long-suffering.
Yes.
The Lord is long-suffering.
Uh-huh.
And of great mercy.
Yes.
Forgiving iniquity.
Yes.
And transgression.
Uh-huh.
And by no means...
Here is Moses begging God on behalf of the children of Israel. After their display of unbelief before God. And God stood and swore by his name that all these people that saw his glory in Egypt before the Red Sea and yet failed to believe in him, that all these people will not enter into the promised land. Continue.
And by no means clearing the guilty.
Yes.
Visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children.
Uh-huh.
Unto the third and fourth generation.
Yes. And why she's reading that? Deuteronomy 3 from 23. Yes.
Pardon, I beseech thee.
He says, pardon, I beseech thee.
The iniquity of this people.
The iniquity of this people.
According unto the greatness of thy mercy.
Yes.
And as thou hast forgiven this people.
Yes.
From Egypt even until now.
Yes.
And the Lord said.
Yes.
I have pardoned according
he
to thy
says,
word.
He says, I have pardoned according to your word. But
as truly as I live,
says the Lord,
all the earth shall be filled with the glory of God.
The earth shall be filled with the glory of God.
Because all those men which have seen my glory,
who saw the glory of God,
and my
who saw his might, who saw the might before the Red Sea, who he fed with manna from heaven, men and women that were led by that cloud of fire, yes,
which I did in Egypt,
uh-huh,
and in the wilderness,
yes,
and have tempted me now this 10 times.
Yes.
And have not hearkened to my voice.
Yes.
Surely they shall not see the land which I swear unto their fathers.
They shall not see that land. Occasion number one. Moses pleaded. He asked God, let me see what you look like. And God hearkened unto him. Occasion number one. Moses is pleading with God. Let these people enter into that promised land. But the Lord refused. Deuteronomy 3.
And I besought the Lord at that time.
Yes, this is Moses now.
Saying,
yes,
O Lord God,
Oh Lord God,
thou hast begun to show thy servant thy greatness.
You have showed your servant, this is Moses now talking, your greatness, yes?
And thy mighty hand.
And your mighty hand.
For what God is there in heaven?
What God is there in heaven?
Or in earth?
Or in earth?
That can do according to thy word.
That can do according to your word.
According to thy might.
Yes.
I pray thee.
Yes.
Let me go over.
Let me go over. Father, let me go over into that promised land. Yes.
And see the good land that is beyond Jordan.
Yes.
That goodly mountain.
Yes.
And Lebanon.
Yes.
But the Lord was wroth with me.
The Lord was wroth with him and said,
for your sakes, and will not hear me.
Uh-huh.
And the Lord said unto me,
the Lord said unto him,
let it suffice thee.
Let it suffice thee.
Speak no more unto me of this matter.
Speak no more to me about this.
Get thee up with the top of Pisgah.
Yes.
And lift up thine eyes westward.
Yes.
And northward.
Yes.
And southward and eastward. And
yes.
Behold it.
Mm-hmm.
With your own eyes.
Yes.
But thou shalt not go over this Jordan.
You will see it with your eyes. Mm. But you shall not go over this Jordan. Why? Because of that sin of unbelief in the book of Numbers 20:12, where the Lord said, sanctify you before the people.
And the Lord spake unto Moses,
yes,
and Aaron,
yes,
because ye believed me not.
Because you believed me not.
To sanctify me in the eyes
to
of Israel.
To sanctify me before the children of Israel.
Therefore ye shall not bring this congregation
into
the land.
Therefore you shall not bring this congregation into the land. Moses, as we know, was a man that killed in Egypt. But yet, that did not stop God from choosing him to lead the children of Israel. I do not know the mind of God. Yes, the commandment says, thou shalt not kill. But that did not stop God from anointing him and sending him on this journey. That did not prevent God from speaking to this man face to face. Everything that Moses looked unto heaven for, the Lord gave unto him. But because of this sin of unbelief, the Lord's wrath was kindled against Moses. Children of God, Israel was alone with God for 40 years in the wilderness. The ark of God was in their midst. The cloud of fire led them. The man of God, Moses, who spoke to God face to face, was with them. But despite this, they continue to display unbelief before God. And they paid a great price for this. This is an example for you and I to pay attention to. Because we also have been in the presence of God for many years. I don't know when you decided to follow Christ. But we only just celebrated the 17th year anniversary of this church. And for those that have been with this church since the inception, I can attest to it that we all have been in the presence of God for at least 17 years. We have experienced the goodness of God. We have seen the glory of God. At least once in those 17 years, God has done something great for you. So why then are we still living in that life that is not anchored on the faith that believes in God and God only? I don't care how righteous you think you may be or how holy you feel you are before God. I don't care how often you think you come to church. If your worship is not anchored on faith in God, total faith in God, then everything is just a waste of time. My God is unstoppable. My God is a limitless God. Jesus Christ, our Lord. My God is a God who's able to do things that seem impossible in the face and in the eyes of man. Do you believe in this God? Voice of grace, I said, do you believe in this God?
Yes.
In today's second lesson, the Bible makes us understand that when the disciples of Christ saw the multitude sitting down to listen to the word of God, they became afraid and concerned about how they were going to go about feeding these people. They failed to recognize that they were in the presence of the Most High, who is able to use the ordinary things of this world to provide extraordinary blessings. Despite all the great things they had seen the Lord do, they were still afraid, saying, how would we do this? And this God, who's unstoppable, not only fed these 5,000 people, but they were fed so much that even after they ate, there was enough food left behind to fill 12 baskets. Children of God, yours is not to question how God is going to bless you. When God says he's going to do it, all you have to do is believe it. Don't question how he's going to do it. We often question, how is God going to do this? Moses questioned, God, how are you going to do this? How are you going to do this? The amazing thing about this is we often pray to God, saying, God, do this. God, do this. God, do this. And then when God hearkens unto our prayers, we then begin to question, how are you going to do it? Let's look at the book of Luke 1. Book of Luke, chapter 1, from verse 12. This is Zacharias, when the angel of God appeared to him after he had prayed for a child.
Zacharias,
yes,
saw him.
Yes, Zacharias saw him.
He was troubled and fear fell upon him.
He was troubled and fear fell upon him.
But the angel said unto him,
but the angel of God said unto him,
fear not.
Do not be afraid.
Zacharias. For thy prayer is heard.
Because what?
And
because your prayers have been answered. So angel Gabriel only came to Zacharias because he had been praying unto God for something.
And thy wife?
And your wife, yes.
Elizabeth shall bear thee a son.
Yes.
And thou shalt call his name John.
Yes.
And thou shalt have joy and gladness.
Yes.
And
Go to verse 18.
And Zechariah said unto the angel.
And Zechariah said unto the angel.
Whereby shall I know this?
How am I going to know this? How are you going to be able to do this? Yes.
For I am an old man.
If you're an old man, and you know you're an old man, why are you praying to God for a child?
And my wife, well stricken in years.
Hold on. Why are you praying to God for a child then? If you've already placed the might of God within four walls, why then are you praying unto him? You believe that he can do it. That is why you get on your knees and you pray to him. And now the angel of God comes before you and says, your prayers have been answered. And then you say, Father God, I'm too old. How are you going to do this? How are you going to do this? Finish that.
And the angel answering him,
said unto him,
I am Gabriel. That stands in the presence of God. And am sent to speak unto thee.
And I've sent to speak unto you.
And to soothe thee.
And to soothe you.
These glad tidings.
Yes.
And behold.
Behold.
Thou shalt be dumb.
Yeah, may we never be dumb in the name of Jesus.
And not able to speak.
Yes.
Until the day these things shall be performed.
Until the day that these things shall be performed. Because what?
Because
you did not believe in the words of God. When God makes a promise unto you, because God is not man that he must lie, he will fulfill those promises. Yes. The question is, would you enjoy in those blessings? The children of Israel prayed unto God, God, let us out of this place called Egypt. The Lord answered them. He answered. And the moment they got before the Red Sea, God, why did you take us out of Egypt? Why? If we had died in Egypt, they would have at least buried us. Now you bring us before this Red Sea, where our bones and our flesh will just lay out there. You ask of God, God answers, and then you begin to question, how are you going to be able to do it? God, I want my green card. I want my citizenship. God said, I have done it. But how are you going to be able to do it? When Trump is saying he's going to deport everyone, whether you have your blue passport or not, he's going to deport everyone. You begin to say, how is God going to do it? If you don't believe God can do it, then don't ask of God. Don't pray. Continue to live in your fear and don't pray unto God. Because if you pray and then you question that God, you're preventing your salvation. You're standing between your salvation. Look at all the sins the children of Israel committed. God never stood on vow and said they will not enter the promised land. He never said it. Moses killed. But simply because of their unbelief. So for your sake, just stop praying. Because if you pray, because I know that this God is unstoppable, yes. He will definitely answer your prayers. Yes. He will answer my prayers. Yes. And because I believe in this God, before this day ends, God will do an amazing thing in my life. God, just say amen. God will do an amazing thing in my life. Only say it if you believe. I'm saying it because I believe. Before this day comes to an end, you will rejoice with me. God also does not like jealousy. Just say amen to my prayer. Your unbelief will not stop God from moving. Never. Because His word, like Americans will say, is bond. His word will never change. Never. But when the fulfillment of that blessing manifests, the question is, will you enjoy in that blessing? When you feel there's a limit to your God, when you feel that something seems impossible, Book of 2 Kings, verse 7, chapter 7 from verse 1.
Then Elisha said, Hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus said the Lord.
Yes.
Tomorrow.
Yes.
About this time.
Yes.
Shall a measure of fine flour.
Yes.
Be sold for a shekel.
This is the time when Samaria was going through a famine that had never been seen before in that time. And now a man of God comes before a bunch of hungry people, saying, by this time tomorrow, within 24 hours, you will eat and eat and eat until you're tired. I don't care how faithful you think you are. Go to Syria now, where people are starving to death, and go preach the word of God to them and see if they don't stone you. Now a man of God, Elisha, is saying, by this time tomorrow, you all will eat. Yes, continue.
And 2 measures of barley for a shekel.
Yes.
In the gates of Samaria.
Yes.
Then a lord in whose hand the king leaned,
uh-huh,
answered the man of God.
Yes.
And said,
yes,
behold,
yes,
if the Lord will make windows in heaven.
Now this is the noble man of the king, the hand of the king. For those who watch
Game of Thrones.
The hand of the king, they call him. Yes.
Behold, if the Lord will make windows in heaven.
If God even makes windows in heaven.
Might this sin be.
And he said. Behold.
Thou shalt see it with thine eyes.
You will see it with your eyes.
But shall not eat thereof.
Uh-huh.
And there were 4 leprous
men. Go to verse 18.
And it came to pass.
As
the man of God had spoken to the king,
yes,
saying,
yes,
2 measures of barley for a shekel,
yes,
and a measure of fine flour for a shekel,
yes,
shall be tomorrow,
yes,
about this time in the gates of Samaria.
Yes.
And the Lord answered the man of God and said,
Now behold,
if the Lord should make windows in heaven,
yes,
might such a thing be?
Yes.
And he said,
yes,
behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes,
yes,
but shalt not eat thereof.
Yes.
And so it fell out unto him.
Yes.
For the people showed upon him.
They stamped upon him when they were rushing.
And he died.
No, finish. That's verse 20.
And he died.
Okay. When Elisha came and said this, the nobleman was thinking about how God was going to do this. The problem is when we're constantly thinking about God is going to do certain things in our lives, we run into that trouble and that boat of unbelief. The enemies that were coming to fight against the children of Samaria were the ones that brought a bunch of food in their camp, and they said, the Lord created a sound of chariots. So many of them, to the point where the soldiers became afraid, they ran and they left the food. Their enemies were the instrument God used to bless the children of Samaria. The ways of God are mysterious. If you're thinking about how God is going to do this or do that, just believe that God will do it. No matter what the situation is. No matter what the situation is. God will do it.
Amen.
Praying and fasting is good. It's good. It's really good. But I will show you people in the Bible that simply believed in the word of God and they received from God. Book of Matthew 8, verse 5.
And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum,
yes,
there came unto him a centurion beseeching him.
A centurion came unto him and beseeched the Lord.
And said
unto him,
Lord, my servant lieth at home sick of the palsy.
My servant lies at home on a sick bed, about to die,
grievously tormented.
Yes.
And Jesus said unto him.
I
will come and heal him.
Yes.
The centurion answered and said.
Lord.
I am not worthy that thou shouldest.
Worthy for you to come under my roof.
But speak thy word only.
Speak your word only.
And my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me.
Yes.
And I say to this man, go.
Yes.
And he goeth.
Yes.
And to another, come, and he cometh.
Yes.
And to my servant, do this, and he doeth it.
Yes, yes.
When Jesus heard it,
yes,
he marveled.
He marveled.
And said unto them that followed.
And said unto them that followed.
Verily I say unto
you. Verily I say unto you.
I have not found so great faith.
I have not found so great faith.
No.
No.
Not in Israel.
Not in Israel.
And I say unto you.
And I say unto you.
Many shall come from the east and the west.
Yes.
And shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven.
Yes.
But the children of the kingdom shall be cast into outer darkness. Where there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said unto the centurion,
yes,
go thy way.
Go thy way, because
and as thou hast believed,
as you have believed,
so shall it be done unto
you. So shall it be done. As you have believed, so shall it be done unto you.
The servant
Jesus
was healed.
And the servant was healed.
At that very hour.
At that very moment, the servant received healing. He didn't say this man got on his knees and prayed and fasted. He may have done it, but the Bible didn't tell me that this man did it. All he went was he went to God with faith, believing in this God. And his faith granted his servant the healing. Fasting and prayer is good, but it must be accompanied with total faith in God. Don't be a Christian that prays, but yet continues to doubt. Wait until your faith is strong before you present anything before God. I'm being very, very serious now. Wait until your faith is strong before you present anything before God. Until that time when you believe that God will do it, don't present it before Him. For the sake of your salvation. For the sake of my salvation. Because the moment you present it and the Lord answers and He says He will do it, there can't be any doubt. Yes.
Now the just shall live by faith.
The just shall live by faith.
But if any man draw back,
yes,
my soul shall have no pleasure in him.
If anyone draws back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him.
But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition.
Yes.
But of them that believe.
Of them that believe in the saving of the soul. If you have faith today, and then tomorrow you start to doubt, it is between you and God. We all know the story about the woman with the issue of blood. For 12 years, she prayed. She spent money asking that this illness be taken away from her. One day she heard that the Messiah was coming to town. And the Bible makes us understand that there was a crowd of people before her. That crowd was the wall standing between her and that cure. Instead of staying back, she pushed through the crowd in faith. She didn't even ask God to pray for her. She just said, I know if I touch His garment. Imagine that faith. If I touch His garment, I know I will receive healing. And that's all she did. She didn't ask for seven members prayer. It's great. All she did was she pushed through that crowd, believing that God will do it. And she received her healing. Take a step back, children of Voice of Grace, and bring into remembrance all those things that the Most High God has done in your life. Bring into remembrance the goodness that God has placed in your life. how often he is taking you out of the jaws of Satan. And even those battles that he has fought on your behalf that you don't even know about. There's so many things God has done for us. Because God is not like you and I. He will not bring everything before you saying, see what I have done for you. There's so many things he has done on your behalf that you don't even know about. And now that you find yourself in a dire situation, I ask, child of God, why are you becoming faithless before God? The God who parted the Red Sea is still very much alive today. The God who created the heavens and the earth is still very much alive today. Don't always look at the size of your problem. Look at the size of your God. Don't look at the ordinary situation that you find yourself in. Look at that God who took Joseph out of prison and made him king, the second in command unto the king of Egypt. That is the God that I serve. I would be lying to you if I said you will not face problems. Even Christ said you will face problems. But so far as you remain steadfast in the Lord, you will see those problems. You will look back and you will find those problems no more in Jesus' name. Just believe in that unstoppable God. It will move on your behalf. It will move on my behalf.
Amen.
Whatever your situation is, whatever it might be, I know and I believe that God will resolve that situation.
Amen.
Prayer and fasting is good, but your total faith in God is paramount. And here's the conclusion of the matter. Book of Matthew 13, 56 to 58.
And his sisters, are they not all with us? What then has this man...
Read it properly, please.
And his sisters, are they not all with us?
Yes.
Whence then hath this man all these things? And they were offended in him.
Book of Matthew 13, 56 to 58. Okay. Oh yeah, go ahead.
7. And they were offended in him.
Yes.
But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor.
Yes.
Save in his own country.
Yes.
And in his own house.
Yes.
And he did not many mighty works.
And the Lord did not do many mighty works.
There because of their unbelief.
Because of their unbelief. God will do mighty works in our lives.
Amen.
All we have to do is believe in God. For the might, the grace of God never depart from us. And any wall of Jericho that may be surrounding anyone in here, because we're serving an unstoppable God, those walls will be brought down today.
Yes.
May the Almighty bless his words.
Amen.